In the past, I have tried to repair low-cost consumer electronics that often use phenolic resin-bonded PCBs, as well as chip-on-board style ICs. However, the first two times that I attempted this, the devices unfortunately did not make it through their surgery. However, in both of these situations, all that I was doing was just using hot air to replace some surface mount resistors and capacitors in somewhat close vicinity to the chip-on-board. But despite this, the chip on board started to fizz and crackle and pop, and then parts of the epoxy would go missing and the device would stop working. So I have here a PCB that we shall be sacrificing for science, and this PCB is probably from about 2005. This is from a children's toy where you press the buttons on the keypad and it will make a bunch of sounds. But the thing that's important to us is that it uses a chip-on-board IC, which is under this black blob here. And on the back, we can see that it's brown, which is a telltale sign that this is a phenolic PCB. So I've got the hot air gun set at 260 degrees Celsius, which is the sort of temperature you want to use for lead-free soldering. And I've got it pointed at that blob, so hopefully we can see some of that snap, crackle, pop action. Ooh, yeah. And that's the other thing. Not only do these chip-on-boards not like the heat, but these are phenolic PCBs. Their lamination is nowhere near as good as woven fiberglass PCBs. And as you can see here, yeah, it's developed a bit of a bump where it's delaminated. So the lesson here is that if you have to rework a resin-bonded PCB or do anything near a chip-on-board device, it's a good idea to bake the PCB first to remove any moisture, as well as try to use a lower temperature. However, the best course of action is to just use a soldering iron. And if you have to desolder a multi-pin SMT part, instead of using hot air, you can just cut the leads and take the part off that way, and then resolder it by hand with a soldering iron. Now, whilst I have this, I want to actually take a dig at this bubble here, just to see what sort of damage it's done to the thing. And it turns out this is actually a pretty good way of getting the blob off. You can just get your tweezers under it and rip it off. And then you can put the epoxy blob in some solvent for a while. And then you can get some die shots like this. But yeah, it looks like the first layer of this phenolic board has completely delaminated from all of the other layers, and it's just made this bubble here. And you can really see that on the other side of the PCB. So let's do this again and see if we can delaminate all of the layers in this PCB. And of course I'll get that microphone in nice and close for you so that you can hear that nice horrific snap, crackle, pop ASMR. So this shot's at 10 times speed and the hot air gun is set to 300 degrees Celsius, and you can really see the phenolic PCB discolor. This is pretty much why you don't want to use a phenolic PCB for anything apart from the lowest cost consumer garbage, because fiberglass FR4 is pretty much so much better in every single way apart from cost. And even that is pretty marginal. So here I'm just going to break the PCB in half so we can see all of those layers that have hopefully delaminated. So yeah, it looks like we've delaminated all of the layers. It looks like it's made up of three different distinct fiber layers that have been bonded together. Interestingly, the delamination here is actually pretty extreme. There's a surprising amount of space in between these layers that's been made by the gas. So I presume either quite a lot of moisture has been in this PCB that's vaporized and created quite high pressures. Either that, or maybe the adhesive that bonds these layers together, maybe it's decomposing or something, which is adding to this. Here's part of the PCB that hasn't delaminated, and as you can see, the layers are pretty much indistinguishable from each other. And then we've got this bit here where the layers have just completely splayed apart, and the three distinct layers are very obvious. You can also see the very thin piece of solder resist on the top, as well as the very thin copper trace. So yeah, I hope this video has taught you something about what you shouldn't do with phenolic PCBs and chip-on-board devices. So hopefully you don't have to go through the two first-time failed attempts at this. Now, I was also going to talk about the moisture sensitivity level of normal SMT components as well in this video, but I think it's gotten a little long. So I'll leave that to a video in the future. But as always, thanks for watching.